First off, it's all about consent. Second of all, I already said I ain't taking the eye out and doing it. She's got to already have the eye removed, and it's got to be like okay with her. Otherwise, I am not about that life.
Some
I'm gonna
hostile
go
shit.
now. Oh.
Well, yes, that's gonna do our show for
I don't
tonight.
understand. I want to go now. He missed three. He missed key.
Chansey, damn it. Damn it, Lurch, get back in the basement. You're freaking out the guest. But, yes, that.
Music. Well, I had panic disorder, rage, severe depression. On top of all that, I'm stressing. Took a blind date to my therapy session and then tried to kill her. Her first impression was I'm groovy. I need a lumbotomy.
Yes.
But when I press play, trouble leaves up out of me. Fuck the real world in my fat ass stuck in. Cause in my music, hotties are fucking expression. Getting out all I wrote. Depression, ripping out all your throat. And if my hearing was ever to go, mass murder would be inevitable. I'm a.
Welcome to this week's episode of Maniacal Music Musings, or as we affectionately call it, The Cube. As always, I am joined by my fellow co-host, Jeremy Bryant. How are you today, Jeremy?
Oh, you know, being attacked on the left and right on Facebook for comments I make, but what else is new on every day? So let's just have a good show, and I got my vape, I got my drink, my long drink, and let's get this going. And as always, always, we are joined by a guest this week, a guest I have been waiting a long time for because she is our first non-bastard-oriented guest, though she has been a guest on Bracket Bastards since last weekend. But, and that, of course, is Amanda Kohlhofer, or as she might like be called, as she might like to be called today, Lisa Sawyer, from the Sip List podcast, and which is a podcast I've been on twice solo, and Chansey and I were on once together.
Yeah.
And, we're going to be on a few episodes. I'm going to be on a few episodes of it coming up eventually at some point, too, as well, again and again. And other shows she's on, because me and Amanda are friends now. So, yay! But, so, as always, we all brought our CDs to the table this week to compare and to just go and see what's going on.
Yeah.
And as always, our guest goes first with her CD. So, Amanda, tell the audience what CD you brought to the table and why you love it so.
Okay, well, I thank you for having me, first of all.
Pleasure is ours.
Have the album, and I should have known. I can't remember if this is his debut album or not. I don't think it is, but I could be wrong.
I don't think it is either.
But
I'm pretty sure it's not.
Okay. He is a Fort Worth native, which is where I live, and surprisingly enough, when he released this album, he was 25 years old, and you would never guess that by listening to it if you didn't know who he was. And it is Coming Home by Leon Bridges.
I don't really know her destination, but I got a feeling I need to be her passenger. She could let me be your passenger. I should. Said I like the way, said I like the way, yeah. You sail your ship out, and maybe your cargo. I won't break you down, no honey, I won't wear you down.
And why is it so important to you? Why do you love it?
I mean, it just, you know, I'm very much into soul and blues and like we're kind of talking about off air. I don't know if you're going to make a joke about it, but Otis Redding and, you know,
Motown, man,
Sam, all of that kind of, I love blues and just soul. And I love that.
See, that's what's up. See, that's what's up. Yeah. I love the blues and I love Motown and I love that stuff. Jeremy was hating on my blues albums. Every time I put them up, every time I put up a blues album, he hates on it.
Not true. I like blues, but it has to be some upbeat shit in there as well. Not the freaking depressing Sunhouse.
It's the blues.
Yeah, right? It's not called the fucking happy, sir.
But even they get laid once in a while, so they're happy once in a while.
Hey, a lot of times blues is very upbeat. It's one of my favorite genres to cook dinner to. I listen to a lot of it. And, you know, we got kind of a resurgence of bringing that to the modern table with, you know, Leon Bridges and Alabama Shakes, who I also
I love the Alabama Shakes. Oh my God, I'm so glad you brought them up.
So they've brought this old-timey genre back to the forefront. And, you know, this album is definitely more bluesy and soul, and it feels old, even though it's not. But he has a lot of other stuff, too. Like, some of his newer stuff is, like, some really nice R&B. Like, he changes it up. And I don't know. This album is so beautiful. And my number one song from the album, whenever we get to that, is one of my favorite songs of all time. It makes my heart hurt because it's so good.
Which, yeah, I mean, we'll get to the songs when we get to our top fives, but which just so you know, Amanda, in this show, which I did kind of steal the top five idea from your show, just a little truthfulness there, which I knew you wouldn't
invent that.
I know that, but still, I gotta be truthful because that's how I am. But so, yeah, the way we do it in this show is we all give our reviews of each CD, and then we go to the top fives.
Yep.
And we get the top five all at once, and you start with your honorable mentions, and then you go to number five, which is a little bit different from how you do it on your show and from how we were doing it on TBA before that show got canceled. But so, Chancey, let's hear your review of Amanda CD, because it always makes me giggle though when you give reviews.
So. Literally, like I said beforehand, I did. I enjoyed the album. So going into this, like, I want everyone to know that, and I mean, you know, like the audience as well as everyone on the show, that I equally wrote roasts for all of our albums. Like, while I was listening to Amanda's album, the whole fucking time, I literally was like, I feel like I'm fixing to get called to Vietnam at any fucking moment. I had to double take to find out when this shit, you know, when it came the fuck out. Like, I was like, I didn't believe in time travel till I heard this shit. And I thought it was like, I was like, until I realized this came out in 2015, I was like, oh shit.
Right.
But, you know, and also at the same time, the reason that I felt like it was, you know, like you had said, it's like it encompasses so much, you know, classic, iconic sound from the times, you know, the time frame, not even just like the genre itself. Literally, at times, the CD felt so vanilla, I felt like I had to push two twin beds together to fuck my girlfriend.
Come on.
Having said that, I really did enjoy the album. Like, I did. I had to find funny shit to say about it because it was just like, I gotta fucking, that's me. That's my purpose on this show.
Well, that was a good one.
Thank you. But yes, definitely a thumbs up. I enjoyed the album. It's not you're not gonna get a complaint out of me from it. Now I'm here. I'm curious to hear Mr. Jeremy's album here.
Well, as the master of everything heavy and metalish in my mind, but I did enjoy this album actually a lot more than I thought I would, because as Chancey knows by now, but as Amanda might not know, I am truly one of those people who knows what music I like and knows what, and everything else to me is just keep it on the radio, keep it on my stereo. But I do find surprises on this show very often lately, because I did enjoy this CD 100%, because it was a good CD. I picked the top five, and I got two honorable mentions even, because there was that many tracks I enjoyed. Some tracks were like, I don't want to skip it, but I kind of want to, and I didn't. Yeah. But because I refuse to skip, that's my rule. I can't skip tracks for this show, but unlike on Bracket Bastards, but. They also give me the most bullshit radio shit, though. So, yeah. But this CD I actually enjoyed greatly. I mean, it did. I mean, it was kind of like the end of a work day, and I turned it on, like, as I'm on my last couple stops for work, and I'm just, like, rocking out to it. I'm like, all right, I can appreciate this. Mm-hmm. And then my wife made me run back out to the liquor store, and I wanted to kill her. But because once I'm home, I hate leaving. But
right?
Exactly. Message me at least. I may say no, but at least you could try. Because I don't like when my wife drinks, but that's personal shit. But so, and she doesn't like when I drink either. So it's equal. But so, yeah, I did enjoy the CD greatly. So As Yay. Always, as always, and this will be the way it goes for every CD, you give your top five first, Amanda.
Okay. And I'm going to count down from five, or you said do the honorable mentions first?
Honorable mentions, and then five to one. Yep.
So my honorable mentions were Lisa Sawyer, which is the name I put on my thing. I like that song a lot.
I knew I heard that name somewhere.
Yeah. And then Brown Skin Girl. I really liked that song too. My top five are, so I tend to, and you'll see this when we get to your pick, Jeremy. I tend to go more towards the slower, soulful songs. So I have a couple. My number five is Smooth Sailin'. And I think that might be the most upbeat one on my list, although they all kind of have, you know. But I just really like that one. It makes you just feel like happy-go-lucky, and I really enjoy that. My number four is Mississippi Kisses. And am I supposed to talk about each one of them or just run through it?
You can do it however you like.
Yeah, I was going to say, your dealer's choice.
It brings more emotion into it if you actually talk about it.
Yeah, man.
Well, I'll talk more about the other ones. So, yeah, four Mississippi Kisses. Number three is Shine. And then number two is Coming Home. And that was, you know, obviously it's the title track from the album, but it's, you know, it's just so beautiful. And it's fun, but it's still just like, it brings you a lot of nostalgia, which is one thing about Leon Bridges that I think kind of, like you said, it takes you, I mean, back to a time when we weren't even alive, but right. You can still appreciate what it felt like. And it's kind of like Michael Bublé, how when he came out and he was able to, you know, I feel like Leon Bridges is the soul version of Michael Bublé. And I mean that in a good way, not in a bad
right.
way. It's just, you know, taking you back to times that we weren't even alive for.
Great Depression times. Yeah.
Well, yeah. And my number one song is River. And it's just one of the most beautiful songs I've ever heard in my life. And it actually, you know, got picked up on some TV shows and just other random stuff. So, but it's just, I don't know, when I hear it, it just makes me want to like cry, but also smile, and also maybe like slow dance with somebody, but also maybe just sway by myself and just like give myself a hug. And I'm just like, it's just so powerful to me. So yes, I said, give myself a hug.
Well, I'm not there to give you one. So you got
nothing wrong with exactly. A little self soothing. I mean,
yeah, it's such a warm song to me. Like I don't know. It's just beautiful. So that is my favorite off the entire album.
All right, probably
my favorite song of his.
Funny thing is, we had one song in common, and it was on the opposite side of my top five. But, Chancey, how about you? How'd you line up with Amanda there as you take a puff?
Actually, we also lined up with one, but it was also kind of at the other end of the spectrum of my top five, which is interesting.
Okay, now I'm curious to see if we actually hit the same thing in the same mark, Chancey.
Oh, yeah? That's funny.
I'm interested in that now, but... Hey, I'll go next to my top five.
Yeah.
But so my honorable mentions were Pull Away and Here in My Arms. Because I always tell my wife, as long as you're in my arms, you're the safest you could be. So,
yeah.
And I mean, I do it to get laid, but it means that way in a lot of different ways. But I'm a man. Forgive me.
Do you know that we dream of being touched by our husbands without the expectation of sex?
Well, I rarely get it, so she has the expectation. So, but number five was Out of Line, because I'm out of line constantly when I talk to people. So I love that song, because I was kind of like, they talking about me? But
maybe.
And number four was There She Goes, because it's a good crushing song, because we've all just seen women walk by in a store, and we are like in a restaurant where it's like, damn, and then my wife slaps me for looking at another girl. But no, I'm kidding. But well, she does yell at me. But number three, and Ashley told Senor Harvey Laguerre, this should be the theme song for his show. Number three is A Better Man. I told Harvey, I told Harvey Laguerre that should be the theme song for Men of the Prize podcast, but because, and he didn't respond to that comment, but I told him it should be. But
I can't believe nobody in that chat chimed in on Leon Bridges besides you and me. I was upset.
I thought DeAndre did, but I could be wrong.
Oh, did he? Okay, I could be wrong.
I even tagged Harvey and said, Harvey, this seems like your type of music. And like I'm surprised he wasn't like, oh, yeah. It does feel like
something Harvey would love.
Oh, yeah. Harvey loves this type of blues stuff. Like, I mean, he brought to us Riding with the King with B.B. King and
Eric Clapton.
Yeah, there you go. I don't know why I want to say Bruce Springsteen, but yeah. Number two is Brown Skin Girls, because Brown Skin Girls, who I lost my virginity to, so I kind of have a soft spot for that. But but Brown Skin Girls was oh, yes. And it was a very good song. So it was my number two song. My number one song was Smooth Sailin'. Because it was the most upbeat song, and I love that tempo in it.
Yeah.
And it was just a good song overall.
It's very fun.
But that's my top five. Sir Chancelot, what do you say?
So it's funny, between your honorable mentions and your top five, you literally called out like, pretty much like almost like four out of my five. Funny stuff. You know, I didn't have any honorable mentions for any of our albums, but as you know, as I was listening to you talk, I do recall Brown Skin Girl being quite a good, you know, it's a very good song. And if I were to choose a honorable mention, I would also agree with the two of you that would be a good song for one. My number five was the same number five as Jeremy's, but not for the same reason. I just enjoyed the song and thought it was good, but my number five was Out of Line.
You tell me that you ain't out of line all the time too, boy. Come on. Jess and Q straight thought my album was your album the other week because you're so out of line usually.
You know, when it comes to lines and stuff like that, you know, how they always say there's a fine line between genius and insanity. I snorted it. Fucking, you know, when it comes to lines, I don't fuck around with them. There's what lines.
I played Joe Drake with
that line. Yeah, right? Like, what lines? What lines? Ain't no lines.
I don't draw the lines. I just cross them.
Yeah. Yeah. And then my number four was Here in My Arms.
Nice.
Number three was There She Goes. Now, I had a problem because my number two and my number one should just basically be in the same slot because I couldn't.
We call that a DP.
Right? Initially, I had Shine as my number one. And then Pull Away, I was like, man, I don't know. So I basically Pull Away and Shine are kind of like a tie for both one and two independently. I couldn't put one over the other on that. But that was my top five. And then, you know, I was just counting my blessings. I didn't get, you know, get called up in there for the draft.
Just tell me you have bone spurs.
Bone Spurs, yeah, right. My dad actually was almost called into Vietnam. They actually stopped pulling the draft like 12, it's either 12 days or 12 numbers before his birthday.
Oh, wow, that's crazy.
Yeah.
That my uncle, too. My dad's older brother, like, he almost got, same thing, like, he almost got pulled into Vietnam, but it stopped right before his birthday.
Right.
My parents are too young for that. They were young parents.
Nah, but, and actually, it's funny because I almost forgot to mention that my two honorable mentions, Pull Away and Hear My Arms, they're kind of like opposite songs because, like, usually the girl wants to be here in your arms, she doesn't want you to pull away. So, I mean, I kind of like the difference between that, like, those two songs. Like, I don't know, I thought it was funny.
I can't believe neither of you had River.
It was a good song, but okay. I mean,
too slow.
Too slow. Okay.
It was one of those things where I had the five songs that stuck out, like stood out to me the most. for whatever reason. I mean, I literally got, I shouldn't say I got it out of the way. I got into researching this episode basically as soon as I possibly could.
Right.
So I spent all my free time over the weekend listening to, you know, your album, his album, my album. And I wrote it all down just right out the gate just to have it all done and ready to go. So that way I can, I like to go into every show, whether it be this one or the other one that we're on, fresh with no, like, I like no preconceived recollection.
Just okay,
like I write all my stuff down for the show, for this show. So that way I have all my reference points, but like, I want to keep my, my mind and wits about me so that way I can come up with like non sequiturs and good one-liners to make a fucking, you know, good joke and a good show.
I'm like me who got so, had so much meat in the, one of our first shows that I couldn't even see my list because I went kind of blind for a minute.
I listened to all three albums today to be
you wanted it fresh. Yeah.
That's the way I usually go too. And I used to be working every day, but since I was off today, but
especially Jeremy's, because I had never heard it before. My album I've heard, Chancey's album I've heard, but yours I had never heard before. So I was like, let me listen to all of them today just to, you know.
I was banking on the fact that you probably had heard my album before when I picked it.
It's been a while, other than a few songs, but
let's actually get to that because Chancey. Chancey motherfucking Fancy, it's time to start your album.
Oh yeah, you want me to do mine now?
Yeah. And now I chose your album, sir.
I chose the Gin Blossoms' New Miserable Experience. Tell me if you think it'd be alright. If I could just crash here tonight. You'd see I'm no shape for driving. And it's kind of one of those things that the main reason that I picked it because it has like my two favorite songs by the band on it. And it's amusing because I actually, like, with this album, I was able to kind of bond with my dentist. He's a younger guy and I like will play my music every now, like, cause like I have a lot of dental stuff cause I had a weird, they finally diagnosed it as a severe anxiety disorder, but I would throw up just like all the time and live in constant nausea for like years and years and years. And it just ruined my teeth. And so basically I have like a bachelor's degree in dentistry from the amount of time I've just been hanging out, but I would listen to my music while they're doing the job and the Gin Blossoms came on. He's like, oh, you like the Gin Blossoms? That's awesome. And then it was one of those things where we were like, oh, you know, Jeremy basically threatened my position on the show if I didn't pick a decent album to be nice to the guest.
Lies. Pure, unadulterated lies.
I want to know how you decided that this was a decent and fair album for me.
Well, it was either going to be that. It was either going to be that or like, I forgot the name of the actual album, but it would have been Cannibal Corpse's album that had like Hammer Smashed Face and I Come Blood and, you know, just awfulness. It's a joke. Like, I had no intention. Like, I always try to go when we have guests on. And it's not like a friend of ours or someone we know that we're specifically trying to fuck with. I always try to make sure that whatever album I pick kind of is either in the same vein or in at least remotely the same lane, because I want our show to be approachable and palatable, not only to the audience, but to the guests themselves. Like, I don't want people being, you know, hesitating or being reluctant to come on the show because they aren't necessarily sure what the fuck I'm going to throw at them as an album. Right. I want that to be a situation where they're kind of leery coming on the show to find out what the fuck I'm going to ask them while they're here.
Well, the funny thing is that Jeremy asked if there was any kind of music I didn't really like. And I told him one or one and a half things, and he threw one of those things at me. But
no, I did not.
Okay, fine. It's not exactly what I said, but it was definitely along the same lines. But I'm not mad about it. We'll get there.
We'll get there. Already. But all right. So Amanda, as the guest, you tell Chancey what you thought of his album next.
Okay. So I am a 90s teen. You know, I grew up on Gin Blossoms, and this album was definitely like a lot of 90s nostalgia for me. While I love a lot of their songs and I did enjoy this album, their music to me tends to be extremely repetitive. If you're not listening to the words, the melodies and the sounds and everything is all very, very similar. So if you just have it on the background, it almost sounds like you're listening to like the same two or three songs over and over. But if you listen to the lyrics, then it's different and it's better. So, you know, I like a lot of the songs sound super upbeat, but they're actually not.
Right. That's one of my favorite things.
Like the some of these, I mean, Hey Jealousy.
You right.
Know, it's like that song is dark, y'all, but you have to, people don't know because it's just like, oh, so upbeat and whatever. And the melodies are addictive. Yes, they sound very similar on each song, but I mean, I think they did that for a reason. So, I did not pick honorable mentions for this one because I didn't know I was supposed to do that. So for y'all's albums, I did not.
You're all right. Yeah. It's not an expectation. No, it's not an expectation by any means.
Normally it's even more impressive if you don't.
The biggest roast that I wrote about my album was I didn't expect my own album to suck this bad.
Actually, I lied because I wrote down more than five songs on my other piece of paper. So what's my one honorable mention?
But
don't do that yet. Okay, I'm sorry.
We'll get to those in a second. But
okay.
So, yeah, I mean, I'm drinking gin drinks right now, just to put that out there for Gin Blossoms. But drinking me some Gin Blossoms. But that's my wife wanted to get tonight. So I'm still calling her my fucking girlfriend. We've been married for like a month. I forget, you might want to stop
that, or she's going to think you have an actual girlfriend.
Oh no! Don't tell her that. She already does. She already does, even though I give her no reason to think that. But but yeah. So I did enjoy the CD. And Chance, you said last week to me, oh, you may know one or two of these songs. Motherfucker, I knew four.
Nice.
And that's because I work in fucking retail grocery supermarkets all fucking day. So I hear this shit every fucking day of my life. And it's not as annoying as some songs, but we'll get to that on Harvey's Pop Music Bracket this weekend on Bracket Bastards, but which will be live. But
I don't think I'm
on some of those.
You're on it. All the bastards besides Freddie are on it.
Oh, okay. Well, that's six people though, bro.
Harvey's not going to vote.
Oh, okay. Okay.
As much as it probably pains him, he doesn't want to. He said he will not vote, so there's no fighting over who gets on it.
I'll talk to Harvey so that way he may. I'm sure that most of my votes will probably line up with Harvey anyway.
Motherfucker, you better come on. You got to defend that shit against the younglings. But anyway,
I know, right?
I need your help. But no, I mean, this album was enjoyable. I took my kids to a freaking zoo. Crappy ass zoo today in North Attleboro, Massachusetts. It's a free thing, but government, step up and fix that shit. My wife said it used to be a lot better. But other thing is, so I listened to it with
kids. I hate zoos.
I love zoos.
I hate them.
I feel bad.
I can't do anything with animals in captivity. Can't do it.
I feel bad for the animals, but I love zoos. The kid in me loves zoos. I wanted to be a freaking biologist, zoologist at one point, but I couldn't get through the college because just 7 years of college, I wanted to kill myself. But
I cry every time I go to a zoo, which is never anymore. Anyway.
Oh, I'd actually told a funny story here a couple weeks ago about a monkey playing with itself at the zoo, but anyway.
That's interesting.
Gin Blossoms was a good CD, and I did enjoy it. it made the zoo ride with my kids being loud and annoying in the back seat so much better. So, so I did enjoy it, and I'll get into more of that in my top five with three honorable mentions. But, Chancey, your CD, your top five first.
Yeah. So my number five, I have no honorable mentions, like I said. My number five was 29. And one thing I was like, by the time I got to the end of it, I wrote down, I understand why they called the CD the New Miserable Experience.
I was fearing that was like truth of what it was going to be like. But
and then and then number four was Cheating. And then it made me think about what Shanna said about how the lead singer of the Gin Blossoms worked his way through like 20% of the cast of Friends. And I was like, how this guy get so much ass and still be so Sad Boy Summer?
Right?
some people get a lot of ass and they just aren't satisfied by the lot of ass they get because it ends too soon.
And then number three was Hold Me. I blame the parents.
Okay.
he may be getting dumped every time. We don't know.
Your dad should teach you to hold your wad better.
Yeah, right. I swear to God, this never happens. number three was Hold Me Down. And then obviously number two are the more obvious and mainstream songs from the album. But they were my first exposure to them, and they're my favorite because, in my opinion, they're the catchiest. Number two is Found Out About You, and number one is Hey Jealousy. Hey Jealousy is probably my favorite Gin Blossom song, just not just because of its like popularity and everything. It's just that, you know, when it came out, I mean, I was still pretty young, but for some reason, even as a kid, it like grabbed a hold of me and spoke to me in ways that it probably shouldn't have for the age that I was. But, you know,
a lot of things spoke to you at the age they shouldn't have.
Dude, yeah, if you only knew, man. If you only knew.
Demons included.
Right. It's me, your boy. But yeah, that's my top five. I'm curious to see what Amanda's top five is on this album.
Well, as guests, she goes next. But I will tell you, we only had two in common, Chancey.
Did we? I figured we only would.
I was kind of expecting different, but we'll see.
Well, Chancey, we also had two in common. Except for if you count my honorable mention, then we had three. Oh, actually, no, I lied. My honorable mention is Till I Hear It From You.
Oh, yeah, that was a good one.
So my number five is Pieces of the Night. And I went with more, I'm an emotional human, and the songs that have the most emotional lyrics tend to speak to me. My number four was Hard Away. My number three was 29, but I picked the live version because I liked it better. But either way, great song. But
for
the live version, just I liked it more.
Yeah, it's for sure. Yeah, there's a few things where it's better live than it is in the studio.
For sure. My number two is Until I Fall Away, which is just, I don't know, it's so beautiful and so just like, I don't know. A lot of these songs just made like my inner, you know, 14, 15
inner
year old
angsty.
Heart, so, like, yes, like,
yeah,
remembering, you know.
That's why I was like, how is this guy so Sad Boy Summer?
Right. And then, same number one, Hey Jealousy. I mean, first of all, it is a song that anytime I hear it, I sing along with it because
the
melody is so beautiful.
Every time.
And yeah, it's just so, you can't not sing to it, but also the lyrics are just, my God, like this whole guy is just like, you know, basically if I had to fuck the whole thing up, we might still be together. And,
right,
you know,
story of my life.
and talking about, you know, if you don't expect too much from me, then you might not be let down. And,
right.
you know, if I hadn't blown the whole thing, I might not be alone. Like, it's just so damn, like high school, young love, angst. That is exactly what that is. But it's wrapped up in this upbeat song that's so catchy that you don't know unless you're paying attention.
I absolutely love songs like that. Like, if I had to pick a top 10 of my favorite songs, most of them would be that type of song. Like, Chloroform Girl by Polka Dot Cadaver. I always talk about it all the time. It's literally like, it's an acoustic song, like an acoustic guitar. And it's a very folksy. It sounds like it's written in the 60s, could be played by Bob Dylan.
That sounds but literally amazing.
The lyrics are all, it's all sing about,
Jansy, it's
what?
Sing your lyrics you love from that song. Come on.
The chorus?
I'm writing it
down. Oh, sing I love the chorus is, it goes, I won't sing it because it's kind of a high pitch and I don't know if I'll be able to do it proper. But it's like, it goes, Chloroform Girl, how have you been? Don't let me catch you sleeping again. You're only alive because I like you. It's been 3 years since you've seen the sunlight, but I know you're having fun. Bound, gagged, and chained up in my basement. Like, literally, like, the first line of the song is like, your eyes look just like bullet holes. It must be like, all that crying. Yes, oh, it's fucked up. Dude, it's so awesome.
Amanda's crossing that off her list right the fuck now. But
you're singing it. I'm going, is she a prisoner? Oh, yeah. Oh, absolutely. Bob and Gag. There you go. Yeah. She's definitely
Chloroform Girl. I don't know what gave it away.
Yeah, I mean.
You should still listen to it. Don't cross it off your list.
No, I will.
Give it a listen because it's like it's like Pumped Up Kicks, man. Everybody knows the Pumped Up Kicks is a fucking like same premise.
Yes. We should do a top five on my show about that because I have some, Pumped Up.
Okay.
Definitely one of them.
All right.
Most fucked up songs?
Well, songs that you think are about something that aren't like, okay, I die on this hill every time, anytime somebody brings up this song. I Will Always Love You by Whitney Houston. How many fucking people put that song in their wedding as their wedding song? And it's a goddamn breakup song.
Right?
Like, what are you people doing?
So goodbye. Please don't cry. Yeah, it's a breakup song.
It's a total breakup song.
Oh, shit.
Well, speaking of breakup songs, me and Chancey will be on a bracket for that in the upcoming 6 months or so.
Yes.
I told you, Chancey's like, oh, I'm good to be on either that or love songs. I'm like, me and Harvey are on breakup songs. Go to breakup songs. He's like, okay.
Okay. I gotta go. Yeah.
Yep. It's gonna be at some point.
I wanna play.
If we need a guest, I already told Freddie anything romantic related you wanna be in if you can.
Okay.
But and we do have a lot of guest spots in the next year or so. So I mean
that is true though. I noticed a lot of guest slots.
Because guests help you promote your podcast.
Yes.
Which is why I do things I do with masturbators, and the reason I do this show with all the podcasters is because of that. So, and plus, I'm awesome. So, but my top five.
And if you have any flaws, it's clearly modesty.
Me?
Oh, God. No.
Oh, yeah. You are definitely so modest. Like,
well,
salt of the earth of humility. Absolutely. Please.
What did Shannon say last week? It's not all about you, Jeremy. I'm like, yes, the fuck it is.
I know,
like,
right?
It is all about me, my world. But that's you can ask my wife. She'll agree. But my honorable mentions were Cajun Song, because I dug that down south freaking rockabilly type shit. Like,
and that's amazing. The other thing they threw in there was like these random like country ass songs.
That's facts.
And my next honorable mention, which, when I heard the name of this song, I was like, what the fuck? I'm like, I mean, I get it's like a time song. Like, it's based on a certain time, but... And that would be Slave Dealer's Daughter.
But,
like, I first saw the name of that song, I'm like, what the fuck?
Catchy though.
Oh yeah, then I heard the song and I'm like, all right. Going after someone's daughter that you meet in business transaction. I've been there. I can understand that concept. It doesn't have to be a slave dealer. Oh, I mean, I've traded some hoes in my past, but straight up. But
we call that assist. To quote the Juicy J song, anyway.
Oh, Juicy J. We'll be talking about him shortly, I think, in a few weeks. But another, my last honorable mention was Mrs. Rita. And the god honest truth is, I can't tell you why, because I wrote that down like as like one of the first songs I put in my possible list like 3 days ago, and it was just kind of sitting there. But yeah. If I remember right, it was a pretty damn catchy song with the nice guitar riff in it, so I can go for it.
What's interesting is that song, and I can't remember the other one. When this album came out, those were like the first two singles, and it just flopped. And then like a year later, they re-released it with "Hey Jealousy" as the single, and then it blew up.
Well, it took off like a wildfire.
Yeah,
like a gin blossom fire. But we'll get to that in a minute. Number five was "Just South of Nowhere," because it kind of reminded me of the Offspring song "You Take Me Nowhere," and I think Gin Blossoms came out first, so I think that Offspring might have kind of stole that. But I do love that. It was a good song, and it made me think of that song, which it kind of had the same guitar beat riff along there, too. So I don't know if Offspring heard it and they're like, let's do something similar to this. But number four was "Until I Fall Away," because that is a damn catchy, good song and made me think. My number three, and this is where I differ from you two, is my number three is "Hey Jealousy," because that's one of the four songs I knew.
Right.
Which "Until I Fall Away" is a song I knew as well. But "Hey Jealousy" was, which it's funny because I always thought when I hear it in stores and stuff that they're saying "Hey Jesse."
Or I always thought it was, when I first heard it, I thought it was "Hey Chelsea."
No, I always hear it and I'm always like, I always think it's like, "Hey Jesse." Like they're talking to freaking John Stamos from Full House or something. But. And I always thought it was like about a girl named Jessie, but
no.
I get that now, and I read the lyrics. I was like, oh. But you know,
tomorrow we can drive around this town. Okay, sorry.
Let the cops chase us around. Yeah, it's just like,
oh God, I love it so much. Okay, sorry.
See, it doesn't seem like a good fucking lyric right there at all. It seems like something you wouldn't want to happen. But
well, not that part, but I mean.
I know, I get it, but.
But then he says the past is gone, but something might be found.
To take its place.
Yeah, I know, but man, it was.
Yeah, but jealousy though.
I mean, it's jealousy. Everybody's been there, so everybody can connect to that song. But.
Yeah.
Number two was "Allison Road" because I did like that song better than "Hey Jealousy."
Wow. All right.
I've always liked "Allison Road." I always heard it in stores. I always actually understood the title of that one. So right. Like, I always liked that.
Oh, it's just that's one of those, okay.
It's one of those songs you hear in a store and you like it, but you're never gonna go home and actually like put it on your playlist.
It's not like a song you would hear in a Gap.
I don't. If you think I could fit in the Gap clothes, I've never been able to fit in the fucking Gap clothes. Gap clothes are for fucking anorexic people. But my number one was "Found Out About You."
Oh, I love that song.
Because that was my number one, because I knew that song the most out of all the four I knew. And I always, that's the other one I love more than Allison Road.
That actually, "Hey Jealousy" and "Found Out About You" could be definitely co-headliners, because
it was
for that song. The line that always stuck out to me was, "The love I thought I earned, you gave away for free." I was just like,
Like, that is just rough. So rough.
Yeah, that lyric right there like had me like fucking kind of twisted inside.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, those are just I knew four songs of that freaking album. Every time one of them came out, I was like, oh, they sing this? But because I mean, it's not a band I would ever pay to see live though. I mean,
I would
to see "Hey Jealousy." Anyway.
All right, if it's like $20 a ticket, then maybe. But I'm not paying no fucking $100 a ticket like I would for a lot of bands.
Valid.
But,
I don't know if I there's a lot of I don't dude, there's very few bands I would even pay $100 for a ticket for.
Oh, I'm pretty sure I paid like $60 or $90. I could see Slipknot, but
they all go for that now. That's the thing. Like, it's just
I mean,
crazy.
Yeah, it's not them. It's the arenas.
Yeah, the promoter. Right.
They want the money, and like the band gets very fucking little of it. Like, I mean, they only make so much because they do so many tours. But I mean, I paid a shitload to see Slipknot. I paid a shitload to pay Marilyn Manson, and then I only got to see him in Slayer because my parents were dicks, and I was 17. So I paid a shitload for they paid a shitload for those tickets because they let me put it on their credit card, and once they told me I couldn't go, I'm like, I ain't paying you back for that then.
Oh yeah, I wouldn't have fucking paid him either. I've been like, "Fuck you guys."
Oh, I basically did say that because they were like, "Oh, you're not driving to New York City from, we live like 2 hours from New York City." They're like, "You're 17, you just got your license. You're not driving 2 hours to the city and back at a concert. You're probably gonna find a way to get beer at and probably get drunk at." So, no, I'm like, "But it's Marilyn Manson and Slayer."
Like, I don't give a fuck.
I still haven't seen Marilyn Manson because of that shit. I still haven't seen Marilyn Manson. Now he looks like somebody's old aunt. But if you haven't seen that meme on Facebook, it's pretty funny. But because he does look like someone's Aunt Rhonda.
He looks awful. He looks like he's in terrible fucking condition.
Yeah, he does not.
As he said, and we'll get to this in a episode at some point. I don't love the drugs, but they love me.
I don't like the drugs, but the drugs like me.
Yeah.
Which I love that song, but we'll get to that at some point. Trust me, Marilyn Manson hasn't been touched in this show yet, and he's going to be touched, all right.
The lie detector determined that was a lie.
Well, yeah.
I think one of the reasons that I like, Hey Jealousy so much, like, it's easy to pick a token X song that everybody knows, but I also feel like because the lyrics are so sad and because Doug Hopkins was a big contributor to that song and then took his own life, it's just like, man, like it hits different, you know, like,
right?
I don't know.
It's again, like that. It's like that. Don't worry, be happy song.
Yeah.
Same premise. Dude, every time people play that song, like at a bar or at a party, I always bring that up. I'm always like, you know the story, you know, you heard about the guy who wrote this song? And you're like, no, what happened? Oh, he killed himself. Huh?
Yeah.
Don't worry. Be happy.
It's almost funny. It's almost funny because, I mean, I have a Samsung TV for the first time ever. Like, and we have, like, music video channels because of it on Samsung TV. So
I have that, too.
On the one station, I forget which one it is, Don't Worry, Be Happy comes on like six times in within like 3 hours. Like, they play it constantly, and the video for it is so fucking funny and stupid that it's just like, this guy killed himself after making this video. Like, what the fuck? Like, I could see someone killing themselves after making like a Mr. Rogers video or something, but come on.
The problem is people don't know shit. They don't pay attention either to lyrics, or they don't know stories. It's like Candace Cameron Bure making her 4th of July TikTok decked out in her America garb with playing Born in the USA. Bitch, Born in the USA is a protest song. It is not about being proud to be an American. So stop it. Like,
hey, that was my crush on Crushgasm. Thank you.
Yeah, well, she's a cunt. Oh, sorry.
If I'm going to choose a protest song, I would go with Two Live Crews Banned in the USA, but you know,
I go with Fuck the Police. Fuck.
Oh,
that's also police. Valid.
No,
that album will be coming up at some point in our show in the future, too. Just
okay,
saying. Don't fuck with Sarah.
Anyway. Tangent, sorry,
no, it's all good.
It makes this show better when there's tangents,
yeah.
But all right, so next up is always the best CD in the group of any episode.
It's I hope you're ready for these roasts, motherfucker. You better get some burn cream. You better get some tilapia fucking skins on hand.
I feel like I have some ideas of what you're going to say.
All right.
Well, let me go get my hemorrhoid cream. I'll be right back. All right.
I got my pad, Racha. I'm ready to go.
Well, Avantasia And yes, Freddie, that's how it's pronounced because you couldn't pronounce it in my birthday bracket. But
that's how I pronounced it, and I didn't know. So yay me.
Advantasia?
Yeah. Advantasia.
Oh. It's, I thought he said Advantasia. I was like, no, is that like Advantasia. A medical disease? It's like a medical disorder, isn't it?
It's advantageous.
No, Advantasia was the combination of the words Avalon and Fantasia. Avalon for being from King Arthur stories and Fantasia being Fantasia. So that's where the name came from. Advantasia does not tour America often, if ever they did. I'm not sure they ever did. Because they are a super group. They are not just a regular rock band. They are a super group. They're Tobias Sammet is in. He's from another band. I forget the name of his other band, but they're good too. I just forget the name. They're very generic rock in Europe. But he formed this group back in the, I want to say, early 2000s. And they've had Alice Cooper. They've had the lead singer. Nice. They've had the lead singer of the Scorpions on songs. And they've had a bunch of just different major rock stars from America, from Europe, a lot of them from Europe, but a couple of the Nightwish guys went to a few of their songs there, Chansey, as we talked about Nightwish before. But
Nightwish!
And, I mean, they just do a lot of things with other rocks. So they're a super group. I mean, they're 100% a super group because they can't even do that many concerts because to get all those rock stars together in one place is hard, especially for a full on tour. So if they do tours, it's usually just the music that Tobias sings, like the whole song, basically, or if it's a local star that he can partner up with again real fast. But they are, I found them, I think, on YouTube when I was going through a Wikipedia list of symphonic metal bands. And being an A, they're right at the top. And as soon as I heard a couple of their songs, I was like, oh my God, these people are amazing. Did I find that way? Or I don't fucking know. I really don't know anymore. But
you know, the fact that you mentioned that this is a supergroup makes like at least two or three of my roasts almost funny, almost more amusing. I almost said funnier, but like almost more amusing just because of the fact that
on this album.
What's that?
D. Snyder is on this album.
Yeah, fucking A, dude. That makes like for real though. It's like there's so much. Like I didn't even realize that D was on the album. I thought I was like that sounds like D. Snyder, but still. Oh shit, this is great. I'm so ready for this.
But yes, this album came out in 2016, when I just moved to Massachusetts earlier the previous year, and I freaking went through a horrible heartbreak, and I already loved this band at that point. I didn't find these. Wikipedia. I forgot the fuck I found them. Oh my God. Usually I remember where I find every band, but Advantasia just I thought it was moved up here, but or maybe I think I just got into them before that CD came out. I think I was at work and I found them on Wikipedia, but that CD came out shortly after, and this CD is why I picked this one. It's fucking incredible. Like it helped me get through so much heartbreak and shit because of these songs. And I'll get into that more in my top five by damn far. But Amanda, as a guest, you go next, because I'm saving Chansey's roast for last.
Yeah, Chansey is going to last. So I have never heard of this group.
I expected
and
that.
I have never heard music like this.
I expected that.
Metal is not one of my jams at all. I'm very much like anything past Metallica, I would say, is too heavy for me.
They are not heavier than Metallica. No fucking way.
You know,
say they were. I'm telling you that's my level of metal.
I find it ironic that you say that you don't like metal, but you also like blues because, like, I've always firmly believed that the three closest related genres of music are classical music, blues and heavy metal. Because Black Sabbath, being the progenitor of heavy metal, was initially a blues band before Tony Iommi lost the tips of two of his fingers, which caused him to have to find different strings, detune his guitar a little bit, and then he would take plastic and melt it over the tips of his fingers and put leather straps over it, so that way he could have like a normal looking like length to fingertips or whatever, and it made that thicker tone.
Well, that's some fucked up House of Wax shit,
right? The more you know. Doo, boo, doo, doo.
Exactly.
But no,
the thing about metal is it's when it gets to the point where the music is so loud and overwhelming that you can't hear anything except just like, and then you can't understand what they're saying because they are screaming at the top of their lungs. Like, to me, it stresses me out. It gives me anxiety. So, like Marilyn Manson, for example, some of his stuff I like, some of it is way too hardcore for me where I'm like, I can't enjoy this because it literally sounds like an anxiety attack if you played it out in a band. So
I like to have sex to Marilyn Manson. Like,
No.
So, I don't understand that.
It stresses me out. I'm sorry. It just does.
No, it's fine. It's perfectly fine. But I also look at it from a different perspective, as like I play guitar and I was in choir for 10 years, but like,
right.
So like I listen to when the singer, like you were talking about how you can't understand what they're saying because they're screaming, depending on the band or the artist himself, their voice becomes its own instrument.
Yeah.
And it plays into, the actual song itself. Like, one of the things I thought of when you were talking about how you can't understand what they're saying, and I love the fact, because like once I read the book that has the lyrics in it, then listen to it after that, you can hear exactly what they're saying. But there's this one band called Job for a Cowboy that has this extremely impactful and insightful lyrics about, you know, like just, you know, the nature of reality and like sheep, you know, herders and tribalism and all this, like, you know, don't conform and this, that, and the other, but it's broken down syllable. So like, one, like, you know, if it's a four syllable word, it's like, and it's that four syllables is a single word, but it all ties together with each instrument to make a specific sound. And another example is another album that even Jeremy was giving me shit for, which was a band called Meshuggah, and the name of and the name of the album is Obzin, but there's a song on there called Bleed, and I would recommend that you listen to that only.
I would
like, honestly, even pardon me. M E S H U G G A H.
Okay.
You think fucking Amputation's heavy metal?
If I misspelled it, forgive me, but it'll correct itself. But. The song is called Bleed, but the interesting thing is at the very beginning, like, it starts with this interesting drum beat, but the thing that's so interesting about it, like, this is the drummer for this band is a drummer that other drummers come and watch, and that song is one of the reasons why they do so, because instead of playing, like, you got your normal stuff that they play with the bass drum on the floor, he's doing that up top on all the like the toms and the snares and up top. So he's doing opposite time. So with his feet, he's doing the timing that would be done normally with like with the cymbals and the like the other drums and snares. But the top side is a separate, like, it's just completely inverted and insane,
yeah,
but perfectly blended in the way the sound of the song plays out. But of course, naturally, it goes into like a singer who you can't understand.
I mean, so I get it and appreciate it as an expressive art form.
For like, sure.
I get that that is a thing that people do, and there are people that enjoy it. But for me, I love pretty much all music, but that would be my one genre, is like the super heavy metal that I just, all it does is give me anxiety. And I don't like not being able to understand the lyrics. Like, I really hate that. So
mine's polka. I totally understand.
Hey, polka's not bad if you're drunk.
See, that's
wait,
the thing.
You
I don't love
the Polka Kings from Kenosha, the Kenosha Kickers?
The Kenosha Kickers. No, no.
Home Alone.
I don't care. I don't drink, so I don't. I mean, I don't care much for polka. It's just my thing.
When you're stoned, it's fun to dance to too.
Anyway, all of that being said, I did tell Jeremy that was the genre I don't really like. So when he sent me this and I started to listen to the first song on the album, I was like, okay, he sent me heavy metal. The first song is The Mystery of a Blood Red Rose. And I was like, he's fucking with me. Like, what the fuck? Why do you do this to me? But actually, when I listened to it, I didn't get a lot of the lyrics, and I read that it's like kind of a continuation of a story, but I did like the whole metal opera feel of it.
Right. Yeah.
Rock opera. Yeah, for sure. Vibe, and like a rock opera vibe. Yes. And it was, I mean, amazingly symphonic, and the vocals are just like, so I appreciate all of the musical elements of it. And there were definitely some songs I liked. It's not something I would listen to like over and over again, but I didn't hate it.
Yeah, I mean, it's called symphonic metal for a reason, but
okay, there you go.
So, yeah, I was wondering what the genre of that would call. I was like, is this doom metal or like?
No, they're in the same genre as Nightwish, dude. They're symphonic metal.
Yeah,
they have a full fucking orchestra when they perform, going with their music. So yeah, I mean, same as Nightwish used to back in the day, but. Yeah, Avantasia is symphonic metal. That's why I sent it to you, because if I wanted to give you heavy metal you couldn't understand, I would have gave you Cradle of Filth or Lordy or Slipknot, for God's sake. But I gave you metal I thought you would enjoy, because trust me, if I gave you some of the hardcore rap I listened to, you wouldn't have been into it either. Ask Quentin and Chansey.
Facts.
I made Chansey uncomfortable. That was the funniest fucking thing in the world. I made Chansey uncomfortable.
In my defense, I was also sick.
Oh. There is like some super, super duper gangster rap that I also cannot handle. So those are like the two extremes for me, with the super heavy metal and the super, super rap that I'm like, okay, I need this watered down a little bit for me. Sorry, y'all.
Oh, I know. I should have sent you Backdoor Riders by Psychopathic Riders.
Anyway, when we get to our top five, I'll tell you, I did not hate it. I enjoyed it for what it was. It's not something I'd listen to on repeat, but I did think it was beautiful.
And the literal opening to that song is, let's talk about butt sex. But, so, Chansey, let's hear your... very Comedy Central roast type style of the review.
Please let there be a joke about meatloaf.
A what?
I said, please let there be a joke about meatloaf.
Oh, I'm pretty sure that's
funny. You should mention that.
I was just saying, pretty sure there is.
I was like, I wish I could get this close enough to the camera that you could actually read my notepad. It goes, why does this feel like Dio, Meatloaf, Dee Snider, and Alice Cooper had a weird fucking love child? And then another one from another song was, why didn't you just pick King Diamond? And
never listened to them.
Another one was like, did the band and the studio like double book somehow, which is where the whole supergroup thing came from, because I didn't know it was a supergroup. I was like, did these motherfuckers just double book themselves? Like, you know what? Fuck it. Let's just do it. We're here. Let's just fuck
it. They would do anything for love.
We'll do it, but he won't do that.
Oh, there's very little I won't do, but yeah.
But and like on
Singing Machine.
I have a specific roast on my top five that I'll fucking hold off because it's so fucking good.
And yes, and answer your question, Amanda, if I'm drunk enough, but but I had to be pretty fucking drunk for that one. Like I'm not going to remember this tomorrow. Like I'm not going to remember this tomorrow drunk. I'm taking a shower as soon as we're done. So yeah.
Okay. Changing the sheets too. All right.
Wouldn't be in my bed. That'd be the rule too. But yeah. So all right. So we'll start with my top five. Oh, actually, Chance, are you done or no?
Yeah.
Okay.
For now.
For now. Yeah. So we'll start with my top five. But yes, I just looked it up, and the other band that Tobias Sammet is from is a power metal band called Edguy, E-D-G-U-Y, and that band is actually very fucking good, too. I might actually bring their CDs on eventually. They're not in my library because they're not that good, but they're good. Like, I can listen to them and not get sad or get, like, get disappointed in having to listen to it, but like I did with Sunhouse, but
hey!
I was going to bring that up. But, yeah, I
Sunhouse was good.
If you want to find music to kill yourself to, yeah, sure.
I mean, I did make a suicide joke when Shanna's CD from last week. So
I know. Well, that's the Lumineers, just to be expected. So my four honorable mentions to this, and yes, it was very hard, Chancey, not to pull a Jeremy in this CD in like every fucking song besides my top five. But
I was expecting it. Jesus. You know, he does it all the time.
Oh, trust me. I pulled the Jeremy on Chancey CD last week because I like every song so much. But
which Chancey, I was honored.
And Chancey's pulled Jeremy a few times too.
What was it?
It was my favorite band is called Dog Fashion Disco. They're out of Baltimore. They came out, I want to say, around like the early 2000s initially. And then they went on hiatus for a while, and then they got back together recently, within the past like 3 or 4 years, and then maybe 5 or 6 years, probably. I'm terrible with time.
but Rumpelstiltskin doesn't know when he woke up,
right? But like, they have it's honestly, I kind of call them a modern heavy metal version of Pink Floyd.
Kind of.
Because they have heavy metal-esque songs, and they'll like have on the album in which he was talking about, which is Committed to a Bright Future, there's like heavy metal style songs and that'll break off into piano parts, and then Pogo the Clown is a jazz song about John Wayne Gacy. That's one of those ones I was talking about where it's like, it's that band does a lot of songs.
Write that one down too.
Yeah, Dog Fashion Disco is the name of the band. Pogo the Clown is the name of the song. The name of the album is Committed to a Bright Future. There's a lot of stuff on there, but that Polka Dot Cadaver Chloroform Girl song. The lead singer of Dog Fashion Disco also sings for Polka Dot Cadaver as well.
And yes, there's actually a song on that album called Rapist Eyes.
There is. It's called Rapist Eyes. And it's, you know, it's a really good song.
It is.
Love Song for a Witch is good. Like, dude, like pretty much the first 7, 8 songs on that whole CD is just playable.
And they redid the song. They redid the Grease song.
Yeah, they covered Grease. It's Grease. Better than the original.
Oh, it is. It's so much.
If you don't believe me, then listen to it and then get back to me on that.
I refuse. Anyway, Jeremy, oh, four goodness. Honorable mentions.
Yes,
I refuse. She says.
I refuse.
That's why I told Frey today. If he needs guests, Amanda should be on musicals bracket, but because. Amanda loves musicals, but
I love musicals.
Me and Frey get that, but you should still listen to the song because it's good. Me like, and it really
gonna,
is.
Me and Freddie are going to be on her show eventually to do a top five musicals episode, but maybe around the same time. If she's on the bracket, but we'll see. So my four honorable mentions were, and these were so hard to fucking pick because I wanted to pick them all, but just like a Pokemon, and I want to catch them all, or like the STDs. But my first honorable mention was Unchain the Light, because I do love that song. It's about like letting yourself go, letting your spirit go, and like just doing what you gotta do in life. And it's just like a good motivational song. And let me say, Avantasia and everything they fucking do is amazing sounding. Like this CD alone, like there's not a bad fucking song. Like it all plays together perfectly. And it's not heavy metal, because I hate fucking opposite heavy metal shit where I can't understand what the hell they're saying. But I'm not looking up the lyrics. I got too much other shit to do. But my next honorable mention was Isle of Evermore, because I love any song that has like an Irish or Scottish like lyric like sounding thing to it, and a freaking melody like that, especially with a bagpipe. I mean, Chancey Knows and Nightwish, I like the bagpipe songs the most. But
you like to have your bagpiped?
Oh, who the fuck doesn't? I don't get it enough.
Or pipe bagged.
But yeah, I mean,
I was gonna say that, Chancey.
But I. Hey, Shante.
Hey.
Shante.
Welcome to the show.
But yeah, I mean, Isle of Evermore is an amazing song. It's one of the slower songs on the CD, which I like. I always like it when these type of bands do slow songs, so it's always perfect. It's never like leaves you wanting more. My next honorable mention is Seduction of Decay, because it's basically about being death. It's basically just about you are death and you're trying to get seduce people that, into dying almost. So I love that idea. And
he wants to be dead alone.
And I would love to,
loves company.
And I would love to be death. I mean, it's always been a dream job for me, but
it's a dream job
to be the Grim Reaper. Oh, fuck yeah.
That's funny.
But my next, we're glad you're here too, Shante. The last honorable mention, I had was actually related to my paranormal love, and that is The Haunting. Because it's all like sung from a ghost perspective of everything, and it's just perfect. Like, it's just an amazing freaking song of a ghost singing to a human, like, I will always be watching you. And I mean, I don't remember the exact lyrics, but like similar lyrics to that are always be. I think it's like, oh, trust me. I live with spirits. They are stalkerish. They watch me and my girlfriend, me and my wife argue all the time. Fuck. But it's too new to fucking get to this shit still. So my number five was Master of the Pendulum, which it almost didn't make my top five, but I listened to it a couple times in the car on my last day at work last week. And I was like, I'm like, I do love this fucking song. Like, it's about controlling time. It's about doing what you want with your time, which I'm a big person that I do what I want with my time, as much as my wife hates it, because I podcast too much. Oh, shut up. But not like
I'm
we're doing
to get that over here, too.
Not, oh, that's...
I have to like, record every night.
Because it gives me something you don't. Because
I'm popular. Sorry.
That was good. That
I
was
don't
good
want to be
one.
Punished for being liked.
I'm not okay. I agree with that, but I'm not going into what that just did to me. But but yeah, Master of the Pendulum was a fucking great song. I love it. And number four was Wake Up to the Moon, which I almost didn't put this on my top five either. I mean, it's just too many songs to fucking pick from. My top three I knew, but this one was like, I kept trying to decide which one's four, which one's five, but Wake Up to the Moon is just an amazing song. I mean, it could be in a lot of things. It could be about being an insomniac, or it could be about just someone who works at night and they leave every evening to go to work and they're waking up to the moon, literally. Like, I've been there. I've done that. So this song, like, sticks with me. I literally have worked a day job, took a nap, and worked a night job. So, I mean, I get that completely when you're just leaving your house in the summer when it's dark out to go to work, which is like 9 o'clock at night. So yeah, it's not fun. I'll tell you that much. But number three is one of my favorite, and I'm going to call it a mythological tale because I'm agnostic and I can't believe in this shit fully. But number three is Lucifer, because I'm actually listening to Paradise Lost on podcast version of it on Mythology right now. And I've read it before too, but I love the story of Paradise Lost. Like, that is one of the greatest stories ever fucking told. Fuck the Bible. That's the better version of the Bible. But Paradise Lost is such a good story. It inspired freaking Frankenstein, for God's sake. And the fact they did a song about Lucifer falling, like, it's just perfect. Like, I love that. Another band I love, Powerwolf, Chancey knows them, did a similar song, but we didn't get to that album yet. But I love, I mean, the story of Lucifer is an amazing one. So the fact they did a song about it, it's just, oh, like, anything Lucifer related, I always am down for. And it's not even a satanic way. It's just in a freaking, I mean, it was like 15 years ago, but now it's just like, I respect the story type of thing. I mean, write me a song about Odin and I'll feel the same way, but it should be called Odin the Rapist Eyes.
I, singular.
Oh, no, he's got multiple rapist eyes.
Oh, it's rapist eye? Like, they only have one eye?
Well, no, I thought he was talking about Odin, because I thought Odin lost his eye.
Oh, he's got a second eye a little further down, too, buddy. But him and Zeus, that's the eyes that lead them. But
no doubt.
Listen to mythology, you'll know what I'm talking about. But number two was Draconian Love. Because ever since I first heard this song, this has been one of my favorite songs that Avantasia has ever fucking done. I mean, Draconian Love is just, the voice of the singer on it is amazing. And, I mean, I looked it up. I had to look up what Draconian meant, like, multiple times since this song came out, because I keep forgetting what it means. But basically, I mean, it's just, like, very rough love, like, very rough emotional love. Like, that's always the feeling I got from it. Like, you show me, like, it's like when someone doesn't, when you don't think someone shows you they love you, but they keep saying they do. Mm-hmm. That's the feeling I get from it, but I love that song. It's always been kind of a theme song of mine, too, but not as much as number fucking one. Number one is a song that got me through a horrible breakup that I thought I would lose myself in for years. And two, it actually became the song I would send to girls when I was concerned dating them and saying, if you understand this song, you'll understand me. And that is Let the Storm Descend Upon You. And this is one of those songs that every time it finishes in my freaking car, I had to hit rewind and fucking go back to the beginning of it and just be like, I need to hear this again. It's like an 8-9 minute song too, but it's just such a good song all the way through, which Avantasia does that all the time. But their longer songs are usually the better ones. But like, literally, it's just the idea, shine your light upon the darkness. And I forget the fucking next line is, but something like, I'll be there to guide you. Like, I love that lyric because in my mind, I always was the darkness, and the women that would date me are the ones saving me. So in my mindset, this song spoke volumes to me, and it helped me get through a breakup because I realized that I am darkness and that she is going to shine her light deep enough to get in within it. And that I had to find someone who could. So I literally would send this song to every girl I met on dating apps after we talked for a while. And I would say, if you understand this song, you understand me. A lot of them never wrote back, but
that's
beautiful. A lot of them never wrote back, but I don't.
Okay.
Yeah, Draconian just is like bad or awful or like terrible, like evil or whatever. But
I mean, and just in this song, the freaking bells during the chorus are like the best part.
Yeah.
Like, shine your light into the darkness.
Yeah.
Let the storm descend upon you. Like that. Mm-hmm. Those two lines to me are fucking what it means to like be my lover. And my wife actually got it. So that's, and I met her on Zeus, a fucking dating site. So that's 100% worked eventually. It just took time. Took like 6 months.
I do not oppose that approach to dating. So I will say I did not marry this guy. I went on like 3 dates with him and I slept with him like once. But he did this thing when we were in the car on our first date. And he was like, I'm going to play you a song. And if you don't know it, then I don't know if I can date you anymore. And it was You're the Best by Joe Esposito from The Karate Kid. And I was like, yes. I was like, it's The Karate Kid. I was like, we're soulmates. Spoiler alert, we were not soulmates. But
as it turned out, they were indeed not soulmates.
I do not oppose that approach to dating because sometimes you just need someone who gets you. Like,
oh no, it wasn't even.
He found his Karate Kid girl, you know?
Oh no, it's not even if they know it, because I know they're not going to know it for fucking shit. But it's if you can understand it and see
that too.
Because I am a fucking storm and I will descend upon you, but you got to let me. And you might, you might like the outcome, you might not. But exactly. You don't even know. But so as our guest, Amanda goes next. What are your top five?
Okay. So three of your honorable mentions are in my top five. So that's interesting to me.
Not surprised.
Okay. So like I said before, I tend to pick more romantical, melancholy, slow, and then dramatic and whatever songs. So that's what we're going to go with this. But number five, sorry, was Let the Storm Descend Upon You. But I agree with everything you said. Beautiful song, gorgeous. Like, I really did enjoy it. So
that's all,
the five songs that I picked, I really did like. Like, I would listen to them again. Four was Seduction of Decay. Mm-hmm. Three, Isle of Evermore. Again, I like this, the dramatic, slow. It was like, yeah, I loved it. Two is the only one that wasn't super slow or dramatic, and it was Mystery of a Blood Red Rose. And it was the opening song that I heard, and I actually really liked it. Like, you know, because when I heard it, I thought, Jeremy's fucking with me. This is going to be a super metal song I can't get into, and I dug it. So, and then my number one was The Haunting.
Yeah, I mean, it's funny how much of this is about death, but I mean, Ghostlights is the name of the CD, so that totally makes sense. But because Ghostlights are what they call spirit orbs when people see them, but
not to be confused with Fleshlights.
Yeah. Well, I saw some question on Facebook the other day about like, what would your kid find in their top draw in your top draw? Like, and I was like, yeah, you don't want to know the answer to that because Amanda just said it. But yeah. I haven't used it since I moved my wife, but still.
Mine has a lock on it.
Your flashlight?
My drawer.
Oh, I was going to say, I'm like, explain to me how that works. But
my naughty drawer.
Oof. We need to do a
Mama
video.
Mama has needs. Damn.
Oh, I know. But that's what your husband's for. But
well, yeah, he helps with, yeah, you got to change it up. When you've been married for a long time, it's, you can't, yeah.
You gotta spice it.
Yeah.
And ladies and gentlemen, we transition into Love is Black by Harvey LeGuerre.
Yes.
But no, I'm glad you actually enjoyed this album. I thought you would because of the musical.
It was very beautiful.
It's almost like all their CDs are like a musical. Each CD is like a musical, basically. And they actually have two and three CDs that go into like one big musical. Like, it's freaking huge. Yeah. I mean, the first two CDs are freaking amazing.
There were a few songs I would skip over if I heard it again, but the ones that I listed, I really did like them. I thought they were very
well. That's why,
and grand, and just, you know.
That's why I didn't pull a Jeremy, because there are songs I would skip over too that I'm not like the super fan of, but I do like them. But I'm gonna skip over them. I'm just playing random songs out of my library, and they come on, and I'll be like, yeah, I don't feel like that one right now. But certain ones, like the ones I named, I can't skip over because they're just magical. But and I implore you, if you like them, but you want something a little softer, look up Nightwish. Because Nightwish doesn't get that heavy most of the time, and they are very similar with the symphonic metal.
Okay.
They have a lot of like really slow songs, too, that you'll love. But Sir Chancelot.
Jealousy.
Oh, he's jealous of this, all right. But let's
Chauncey.
Go.
So, for my top five, actually, it's funny, because my number five is also Let the Storm Descend Upon You.
Motherfucker, I'm a mad. But yeah, if you can't relate to this song, you can't relate to this song. But I felt like Chancey would.
I mean, that's why I made my list. I mean, everyone on my list is something that like I enjoyed for, you know, one reason or another. Number four for me was Babylon Vampires.
I knew you'd like that song.
That was a good one.
Yeah, yeah.
Which it's funny because for the longest time in America, that song wasn't allowed to play. They would block it out in a lot of CDs for some reason.
Fucking assholes.
But I mean, I
think that one was a little too hardcore for me. That one was really like kind of heavy, right?
That's a heavier one, but I mean,
yeah.
I honestly didn't know if it would play because I'm so used to it not playing that. Like, I didn't know if it actually would show up on lists. Usually on Spotify, it's grayed out, like one of those songs you can't play.
Oh yeah, no, my YouTube music doesn't have that fucking grayed out shit.
Yeah, I have Apple Music, so
I used to have it. I have a, that's what I use for my driving when I'm not listening to certain CDs. I use Apple Music, but they used to just not have it on the CD at all.
Oh, I heard it.
My number three was Master of the Pendulum.
Yeah, that's a good one.
And the first thing, like, it, because, like, okay, I enjoyed the album, but it was one of those things where, like, the singing was always just so, it always was just almost
Meatloaf-esque,
blatantly over the top, right? And Master of the Pendulum, I remember writing down, this isn't that bad, actually. Not that I thought that anything was bad, but I remember that Master of the Pendulum caught my attention. I was like, hey, this motherfucker, this is a fucking banger. And then my number two song is Draconian Love. And on the side of it, I wrote, who ordered the Wish version of Peter Steele from Typo Negative? Because... it did kind of sound like a Wish, like an off-brand version or a Costco, Walmart version of Peter Steele. It's for the Kirkland brand. What's that?
It's the Kirkland brand.
That's it. Yep. And then
great value.
For me, number one was Ghostlights.
Yeah, it almost made my honorable mentions. It almost did, but I didn't want to do five honorable mentions.
And yeah, that's understandable.
But Ghostlights is a damn good song. I mean, it's a fucking title track, but it's a damn good song. And I mean, it's funny because Mystery of Blood Red Rose is the first song that came out from the CD, and they released a video for it, which the video is kind of pointless and stupid. It's literally Tobias Sammich just playing guitar in a fucking like castle while this woman in red spins around outside. But so I mean, when they first released that, I'm like, oh god, what's this new CD gonna be? And then like they released Let the Storm Descend Upon You next as a lyric video, and I was like, oh, be still my throbbing dick. But but it's just,
down boy.
Oh, I don't say down boy. He's not a boy. He's a man. But I say that a man. But no, I mean, this CD, like when the CD came, oh my God, the CD just is so good to me. Like their newest CD is not as good. I don't think that's why I didn't go with that one. But this CD was fucking amazing. And a lot of their older ones we're going to get to. And we'll get to the new one eventually. And I'm hoping. They go so long before releasing a new CD, though, because they had to find all these guest musicians and guest singers to be on it and everything. I don't even remember what the Alice Cooper song is called, but it's a damn good one. And there's actually another symphonic metal band, starts with the A tube. I can't remember their fucking name. But they actually got so mad that Avantasia got Alice Cooper and they didn't. That the two bands actually did like a, it was called Avantasia versus something, like the name of the band. And it was just like a 3 or 4 track CD so they could sing with Alice Cooper too. But.
Nice.
And as Johnny Depp said, that's the ugliest looking woman I've ever seen. But.
Well, I would also recommend going back to my album for a minute, listening to other more or newer Leon Bridges stuff, because yes, the album Coming Home is very bluesy. It's very soulful. It's very old school everything. But he's mixed it up a little bit moving forward. And so you still get that. But you also get like some of his more R&B stuff has a very like John Legend or like, I don't know. Maybe almost like a Tyrese kind of feel. Like
I like John Legend, but I can't listen to him like in my car or anything. Like when I used to hear him on like the Ellen DeGeneres show or something like that, my mom was watching it. Like he was good, but I can't listen to his CDs actually.
What is it like an immediate ping?
No, not at all.
Oh,
I mean,
love John Legend.
With my mom, it might be an immediate, but I don't know.
It is for me.
I'm sure it is for a lot of ladies.
Anyway,
I am man enough to say he's a good looking man, but unlike Chancy, but oh yeah, Chancy, how you like that? I told Harvey I better be one of his hall passes for his list.
Say what?
How'd you like that? I told Harvey I should be one of his hall passes on his list for Bracket Bastards.
I got a kick out of it.
Yeah. I think Harvey was just like, fuck you, man. Fuck you. But I have a feeling Harvey, I have a feeling Harvey has that reaction a lot to me. DeAndre's what? I have a feeling that Harvey has that reaction to a lot of things I say. Same as DeAndre. But speaking of DeAndre, he's going to be our guest next week. That's right. Next week, we have DeAndre Robinson from Mass Debaters and a constant guest on Bracket Bastards. But before we get to that, we are going to thank our guest Amanda for coming on, because we went through all three CDs and we told you what we love about them. But so
they were amazing.
Yep. It was actually three good CDs, and I can't complain, and I don't think anybody complained about
any of them. Sure, no. I didn't have any complaints, you know. Usually that's a rarity for me.
I mean, it wasn't the Lumineers, at least, but
I like
the Lumineers.
Yeah,
oh my God, they're so slit your wrist music.
I mean, yeah, but I mean, I sometimes, you know, sometimes those things, sometimes you gotta listen to sad songs, you know.
Oh, wait till we listen to Dark Half, motherfucker.
Okay, you want to hear some slit your wrist music? This is the album I almost picked for you guys. Folklore by Taylor Swift.
Oh, you God.
You want to drown yourself.
Oh, I already want to walk in for a fucking highway full of traffic.
Well, I didn't pick it because I knew you guys would.
I was going
to
say.
I would listen. I'd listen to it, but I don't. I mean, I would be like.
It is not her typical stuff.
I'd be like, I'd be like, listen, I got a top five, but I also have a whole long, like, I had to use a couple pages of my papers.
No, it's a good album, but okay, I am a happily married woman, and I listened to this, and I still felt breakup angst. Like, I was still crying over past relationships. That's how good it is.
I mean, as Chancey says he will do for Christina Ricci, which is drag his dick through glass to get
miles, yeah. Miles of broken glass.
Please to smell her fart. Her
just to listen her... to her fart over the telephone.
She's hot.
But as Chancey says he would do for that for Christina Ricci, I'd rather do that than listen to Taylor Swift. So, because Taylor Swift is on like my list of people I never want to fucking listen to in my life.
Besides wow, this, yeah. You're lucky, because that was almost my first pick was Folklore, because it's so different from the typical Swift stuff that you know.
I would have listened to it, but you would have heard about it. That's for fucking sure. But
what if you liked it, dick?
That may have to question the fact that I have a dick. But
okay.
But yeah, so we thank Amanda for coming on this week, because I knew it'd be a good show, because I've done enough work with Amanda and know that me and her bickering is just like the female version of Harvey and me bickering. But so.
Thank you.
So next week we will have DeAndre Robinson on from Masturbators. And I know for a fact, because he told me earlier today, that DeAndre is bringing the album Damn. And I'm going to say it like Ron Simmons. Damn!
Damn! Oh.
By Kendrick Lamar to us next week, which me and Chancey have to listen to that CD, of course, now.
Yep.
And I've never been a fan of Kendrick, I'm going to say that right now, but I never actually been into anything he's done, but I will listen to it, because I listen to AC, someone brings the show out of respect, and I'll see if I like it or not. It's going to be interesting, because I'm not driving around for work every day now, so I don't know when the hell I'm going to listen to music. It's like going to be after a new thing I have to figure out. Like, I don't listen to music when I'm home, but I'll have to figure it out. Maybe when I'm doing reports for work or something, but the CD I'm bringing next week, and for DeAndre, I've been thinking about this for weeks, because I knew he was coming on, and I'm like, it's going to be rap, because
DeAndre I was going to say, it's Garth Brooks, right? Because he said
the thunder
country.
Rolls.
Okay, well, I will shoot myself for listening to Garth Brooks, but
Where's the bodies buried, Garth?
Yeah, but so, for DeAndre, I thought for weeks, what rap CD am I going to bring that he either A, hasn't heard, or B, is not going to fucking turn off so he turns it on? So, I found it, and that is Independence Day by Twisted.
Ooh.
So, I'm bringing him a little bit into the Juggalo world, but I'm not fully pulling him in and making him pay his face yet. So, Chancey, what CD do you bring upon us next week? And this is, I always warn my guests, I have no clue what Chancey will bring, so I can't promise anything.
I don't understand why you gotta be like that. Because every time I always try to be, amenable.
You
no,
try.
That's not,
you
it. Do, that's you, not you, it. That was if I fuck. That's not the right word.
Considerate.
Amenable is the right word. It means gracious or
accommodating.
Accommodating. Thank you. Amenable. That is the right word for that.
Fuck yeah.
Chance, you got it right. Yay.
Hooked on Potnicks. Works for me. But my album, since I'm going to also keep it in the same lane, is an album that I've wanted to bring up, but I've been waiting for the right opportunity, and I think now might be the time. And I'm going to go with 3-6 Mafia, As the Smoke Clears.
Oh, you motherfucker. I love that CD.
As do I, sir. As do I. So you and I are going to have to suffer in trying to narrow it down to 5. I almost want to remove the ability for any honorable mention on that album, just because it'll make it that much more difficult for the two of us to narrow it down.
Is that the one that has Stay Fly on it?
No.
No.
Oh,
okay.
No.
No, this is back when they were a hardcore group.
It's back when they were like...
They were taken after Insane Clown Posse when they first started, trying to be like them.
Well, and they had the feature song with them and Twisted, if I'm not mistaken, on that one.
You're correct.
And then, but, I mean, it's 3-6 Mafia. They've always been like party and about that life, like that's like one of my favorite. What you know about them keys, about that oak. Like, shit.
It's very similar to all the black movies I've been watching for Master Bears lately. It's all about popping and locking and fucking.
No, ever since I can't remember, I've been popping by collar, popping, popping by collar, popping, popping by collar.
It's all about that gang street life, like that. And the first 4 C's are about fucking, literally, just a lot of them are about murder, which is amazing.
It's about that life.
But I hate 3-6 Mafia once MTV got them and they became mainstream. I hate them at that point.
As Juicy J says, you know me, I'm an OG. I don't say it unless I do it.
See, it's funny you said that, Chancey, because I almost brought Killjoy Club for next week. Fucking ICP and 3-6 Mafia's combined rap album.
Nice.
I almost brought it, but I'm like, nah, I don't want 3-6 Mafia because I guarantee he's heard it before. So, and I like to bring shit I don't think people have heard before, because I like to, as Shanna said, this show is a great thing to do because it teaches people about music they never heard before. So there's a reason Marilyn Manson hasn't been in the show yet.
I went with this not so much because of the whole maybe nobody's ever heard of it, but at the same time it's kind of like I want to keep it in the same vein for our next guest. And then at the same time, I have yet to choose a 3-6 Mafia album, and I enjoy 3-6 Mafia a great deal.
Me too. I mean, I haven't chosen one yet either, but there's still more to choose from, so that's a great thing.
And when it came, like, As the Smoke Clears was actually, like, the first album of theirs that I was exposed to directly. I was exposed to a lot of their independent songs beforehand. Through, you know, Napster and
Napster. Only the cool kids know.
I fucked with Napster for a minute before it got shut down. But
I remember you talking about how you were only able to use it for a little bit. I was like, you merely adopted the Napster. I was there in its inception.
Well, thank you guys for having me. I so appreciate it. This is fun.
Oh,
it was an absolute pleasure.
It was a pleasure, and who knows? We'll have our guests back on for a second time at some point in the next.
I really like this. Definitely have me back.
Awesome. We will. I'm super glad that you enjoyed it.
We will. Most of our guests will be coming back on. So at some point,
I'm sure you guys will be back for a sip list. So,
we're always more than happy to. I'm always down for a sip lip. So, but I'll look forward to doing that next Friday night with Masturbators.
Yeah, it's what all the cool kids are doing. If you haven't done Sip Libs, you're not part of the cool kids club.
Fun fact, when Jeremy first brought it up and said something, I thought he said syphilis. I was like, the fuck are we doing? Hold the syphilis, sir.
No, we talked about that in Master Bears last week, too. DeAndre said the same thing, because he's like, man, every time someone says syphilis, I think of syphilis. And I'm like, if you say it fast, it does sound like that. Because the first time I said it to my wife, I'm like, yeah, I'm doing a podcast with Amanda from Syphilis. And she's like, what'd you get from Amanda?
See, I'm like, I was thinking about it in the context of, like, how would it sound if I was trying to explain it? I was a little bit drunk. Hey, I'm going to be on this show. It's called Syphilis.
Okay, we at the SIP list do not promote STDs like syphilis.
We promote enunciation.
Condoms, and good night.
we promote enunciation when we say that name. That's what I do in my house.
We promote SIP. Safe condom sex.
Oh, fuck condoms. they make it less fun.
Well, you know, you got to play it safe unless, you know.
Get her on the pill. But
that's you got to play it safe if you're out in the world. Like, fuck yeah.
Oh, yeah.
That's fucking, like, come on now.
She has to take hormone-affecting pills, and you can't wear a fucking rubber? All right, we got to talk about this later.
Wait, hold on. I'm totally pro-condom. I'm like, I especially out in the world. Like that's Chancy, just...
Chancy needs those back to myself.
Like, I'm married. I don't want to use condoms. That's the perks of being married. But also, I'm too old to be on the pill. And also, the pill sucks. So, what are you going to do? But for people who are not married, just use a fucking condom and maybe have another backup. Because depending on where you live, you can't do shit about fuck if you get pregnant.
Yeah, right.
I mean, I raw dogged it for 15 years and I ain't had no kids. So, I'm good.
You're an asshole. Do you know that?
Oh, God, yes, I do.
Okay.
Chancy does too. It's why he loves me. But
you know, it's a very rare occasion where I actually, you know, come off smelling like a rose, so to speak. So I gotta take it every chance I can.
I mean, Chancy's one to talk about just putting the tip in an eyeball to see how it feels. But
hey,
just
listen,
a second, just to see how it feels.
First off, it's all about consent. Second of all, I already said I ain't taking the eye out and doing it. She's got to already have the eye removed, and it's got to be, like, okay with her. Otherwise, I am not about that life.
Some hostile
I'm going to go
shit.
Now.
Oh.
Well, yes, that's going to do our show
I don't
for
understand. I want to go now.
He missed.
Chancy? Damn it, Lurch. Get back in the basement. You're freaking out the guest. But, yes, that... That'll be our show tonight, and we thank Amanda for coming once again.
Thank you.
We will catch everybody next.
I'm traumatized. Thank you.
Oh, welcome to the show. But we'll be back next week. See you guys then.